Good morning, very much welcome to the special lecture on the brain formula. Today we will talk about an approach to describe with a generic approach function of the brain. We start out questioning a computational infrastructure with the idea that the brain involves smart processing, which in principle is simple, described by few formulas. You can write down half a page of math in order to describe the brain function, and that the complexity actually emerges from the interaction with the environment. You could say the brain is simple, it soaks up the complexity of the environment, and if you look at the brain in isolation, it appears complex. If you look at the brain in interaction with the environment, we see a natural simplicity which is easily captured by quantitative methods. We will make a short discourse on the hippocampus. We need that for understanding the visual hierarchy and the normative approach applied to hierarchical networks, which will cover the second half of the lecture. Let's start with a look at the brain. So, better that way. On this slide, you see a number of brains, mammalian brains. The big one in the center is the human brain. Brains of two different species of monkeys, a cat, rat, and mouse. And first thing you notice is the size of the brain is pretty much different. There's a factor of 3,000, 1,500 milliliters the human brain, half a gram the mouse brain. If you look at the human brain first, we see the cerebral cortex essentially covering all subcortical structures. Second, we see that it appears on first sight rather homogeneous. This is already remarkable because we have many different mental capabilities, yet the cerebral cortex on that level of resolution appears pretty much homogeneous with a unique, with a homogeneous structure. Furthermore, if I take a sample, for example, of the frontal part of the brain and a sample from a lateral part and give it to you, you will have a hard time to tell the difference which was taken where. And with the exception of the primary areas, let's say primary visual cortex, primary motor cortex, it pretty much needs an expert to tell small quantitative differences in cortical structure taken from different regions. Furthermore, today, there is no theory available which assigns significant functional differences to these small quantitative differences. Next step is, if you compare human brain with the different mammalian species, we find pretty much large similarities, which means that the microstructure of the cerebral cortex is pretty much comparable between human and, for example, different species of monkeys. There are small quantitative differences. For example, the gray matter is somewhat thicker in humans, 2 millimeters, whereas in monkeys it can be slightly smaller. But again, it is not clear what the functional significance of these small quantitative differences is. We have to conclude that the cortical structure as it appears to us is rather homogeneous, although we have very different mental capabilities. This is a promise that generic, general principles are to be uncovered. I think this is a very important point if we look at the size of the human cortex. Here in the cerebral cortex we have, let's say, roughly 80 billion neurons. I like to make a comparison. If you imagine you are CEO of a big company and all humans on earth are your employees, and each employee knows, for example, a few hundreds, maybe a few thousand other people, and everybody is talking to all his friends and acquaintances simultaneously. This would be a pretty amazing company with a lot of buzz, but probably you won't get anything useful done. However, that's the way the brain works. And actually it's even 10 times larger, so it has 80 billion neurons, Each neuron on average is connected with a few thousand other neurons, and all are working in parallel and producing amazing capabilities, for example, like language and vision, what we are using right now. So from the conclusion that some general principles are to be discovered, this is a very, very good news, because imagine, in order to understand the human brain, the answer would be as long or as complex as the brain itself. It would not really be useful. Imagine that all the different areas, we would have very highly specialized circuits and computational processes. The answer, how does the brain work, would be as long as the complex structure of the brain itself. Essentially, we would not have understood anything. I must qualify this a little bit, because we do know that not all brain processes are involved in all mental capabilities. For example, Broca's aphasia was one of the very first observations that specific brain regions are associated with very specific functions. Broca reports on a patient named Tan, which had postmortem demonstrated a lesion in a circumscribed region of frontal inferior frontal lobe, today termed Broca's area, and showed a very specific deficit. It was a motoric aphasia. He had problems to articulate. And if I read it to you, as yes, Monday, Dad and Peter, the patient's name, and Dad, hospital, and Wednesday. So you have the impression he actually wants to tell you something, but he has problems to articulate it, to produce it as spoken language. Also, the capability to form structured sentences is maintained. This means that Broca hypothesized that this specific area, Broca's area, has a motor function in the production of language. It is, so to say, the first very specific area we know. And today, with modern imaging techniques, we have a host variety of different functional areas. For example, you can compare Mondrian-like visual stimuli, like the colored pattern on the upper left, compare it to gray level equivalents, and look for the differences in activation. And you will find that a small region on the ventral surface of the brain, the homologue to area V4, will be more activated by the colored stimuli as compared to black and white versions of similar stimuli. If you compare moving stimuli, like indicated with these random dot patterns, where the shades should indicate movement, and compare that to static versions of similar stimuli, you find a different area which is more activated by the moving stimuli as compared to the static ones. So it's again a functional specialization. And with a host of different studies, we can tessellate the cortex into different specialized functional modules. Essentially, it mimics old phrenological observations, like depicted here by a plot from Gallen, who argued that different mental capabilities are linked to different brain regions. He took a very straightforward approach. He thought, well, if in a human a specific capability was well expressed, for example, he was a gifted musician, and in his skull there was a larger indent in a certain region, the brain should have been larger in that region, linking it to his capabilities. For example, he assigned here to the frontal temporal lobe the capability of music. And you find other regions like the joy of quarreling, a sense of justice, love between brother and sister, and many different varieties. At some point in time, we like to smile on this image because it might appear somewhat naive, but essentially what we are doing today is exactly that. The precise assignment of different functions to different regions might vary in modern times as compared to what von Gallen found, but the principle is essentially the same. So, we have a lot of different areas. Let's take a systematic approach. and Corbinian Brodmann, early 20th century, looked at the whole hemisphere in detail, in microscopic detail. He looked at the laminar structure of different cortical regions, specified thickness of different sublaminae, the preponderance of different cell types, and came up with a classification of a total of 52 different cortical areas. So you might say, well, after all, there are different structural, structural differences. And yes, it's true, the classification of Corbinian-Brodmann is used even today. So when we are talking about primary visual cortex, for example, which is located here at the occipital pole, this would be denoted Brodmann area 17, because he started out at the central sulcus, working backward and forward, and he was arriving at number 17 when he investigated the occipital pole of the cortex. However, one must say that primary visual cortex is most probably the area most different from all others, and that the differences between, let's say, area 42 and 22 are pretty minute, and it needs an expert to tell them apart. Furthermore, this expert has no theory available linking differences in structure to differences in function. What's worse, if we look for functional separation, like for example the equivalent of Broca's area in visual processing, we can plot, well actually Fellman and van Essen plotted this whole hierarchy of different visual areas. And you find starting at the bottom the retina and the lateral genic nucleus. In pink it's primary visual cortex, which I just mentioned. And working up we have V2, V4, inferotemporal pole, many, many different visual areas. Nowadays, we know roughly 40 different of these. Problem is that there is not a one-to-one match between a functionally defined area and a structurally defined area. So if I pick, for example, area MT, area MIP, area LIP, or so, they do not match one-to-one to an area defined by Corbinian-Brodmann. And so far, we have to say that the structural definitions of areas does not match the functional definitions. It does not even match for the first major area, Broca's area. Broca's area is located in the region of 44 and Brodmann area 45. So it's encompassing two different anatomically defined areas, but neither one of these in completeness. And so far, we must say differences between structure between different areas are small, we don't understand their functional significance, and they do not match functionally defined areas. And so far, for today, we acknowledge these differences. However, we neglect them from here on. We treat the microstructure of cortex as essentially homogeneous from front to back, from medial to lateral. We claim that there is a structural homogeneity throughout the cerebral cortex combined with functional specialization. Now the question is, how come? And let's go back in history again to Lashley, for example. Lashley did experiments with rats in different behavioral paradigms and applied lesions of varying size in different locations. He was actually interested in functional localization, trying to localize different mental capabilities of rats in different regions. However, he searched in vain, and he could not specify or localize such specific functions, and he came to the conclusion that only the size of the lesion mattered. So if you lesion a lot, the behavior of the animal would be degraded by a large amount, and if you lesion little, it would be degraded a little, but the location of the lesion would not matter. This led to the concept of equipotentiality, so that all cortical regions can, in principle, or do in principle, contribute to any specific function equally. What I proposed in the previous slide is, however, something different. Here I propose that the structure is homogeneous, but due to the interaction with the environment, we have on that homogeneous structure a functional specialization.